thanks for coming. If any of you guys saw my talk at KubeCon, this is the exact same talk, so if you feel like you want to leave or fall asleep, I won't be offended. my name is Aaron Levy. I'm a software engineer at CoreOS, and I do primarily work on Kubernetes-related things. So what I want to talk about today is writing a custom controller. So internally at CoreOS, we kind of use the same pattern to write applications inside of the Kubernetes cluster, both to manage other applications in the cluster, as well as maybe manage things about Kubernetes itself. So one of the first things I want to go over is what exactly is a controller? Like when I say that, what do I kind of mean? And it's essentially an active reconciliation process. So you're taking the current state and you have a desired state and you're trying to bring those into sync. So generalized state, this would be just a loop that constantly is getting the desired version, getting the current version, and then making changes such that your current state is more like your desired state. And so inside of Kubernetes itself, you know, this pattern is used all over the place, the canonical example being the Kubernetes controller manager. And inside of that, there's actually a bunch of controllers that are doing this kind of this sync loop. And you know, the deployment controller, the daemon controller, node, service, endpoint. So for example, the daemon set controller, what it's doing is, you know, you create a daemon set object, and it's going to look at that as the desired state. It's going to say, okay, well, I should have a pod from this daemon set being running on every node. So now I'm going to go look at my current state and look at all of the nodes and see, well, are they actually running that pod or not? If they're not, then I need to create new pods. So I'm going to take my desired state and then look at my current state and bring them into sync. Outside of that, outside of the core Kubernetes components, you know, applications within the cluster also follow the same pattern. So things like kubeDNS, this is watching services and pods, and as those change, as they're added and removed and updated, it's updating DNS entries in your in itself, so that you know you can actually reference these pods or services. Things like the ingress controller or flannel is watching what network addresses are assigned to the nodes and then applying those to the cluster itself. Similarly, Tigera would do the same thing. Or things like etcd operator or the Prometheus operator, where these aren't, these are kind of taking concepts that are not native to Kubernetes itself. So you would be able to, with the etcd operator, say, I want to spin up three new etcd clusters and give it an object, and it's going to now look at that as the desired state and then kind of make that true in your cluster, all kind of following the same kind of sync loop of get the desired state, look at the current state, and then make sure that they're in sync. So how can we actually use controllers? Inside of CoreOS, we do this a lot, but essentially you're able to extend the functionality of existing objects. So this could be maybe you want to do special things based on annotations on a pod or a node. You can add new concepts into the cluster. So I was talking about the etcd operator and you being able to kind of cookie cutter stamp out new etcd clusters. That's not a concept that's native to Kubernetes itself. It's something that was kind of added on top. You can automate administrative tasks that you generally do. Just if you're an admin, you're looking at your cluster, you know what your desired state is, you're gonna make changes to it to try and bring it into that state. But you could just write some code that does this over and over again. Or you could wholesale replace entire components in the cluster. So maybe an example would be kubeproxy for some reason doesn't satisfy all of your needs and you have very particular proxy needs. You could just take it out and then write your own that's very specialized to your exact use case. And the reason that this is possible is that everything is essentially just a client of the API. So even these core components of Kubernetes are just clients against the API. And so we're able to modify the actual functionality of the cluster without modifying the code itself. So it's a really extensible system and a really powerful system. So I want to talk about building an example and going through the steps. It's actually pretty easy. Using some existing libraries of how you can actually build operators and follow these patterns. So as an example, we're gonna build a node reboot operator. I don't find this actually that useful, I don't think. I guess you could find some uses for it, but it's kind of a simple example of how you could build a system that acts on all of these Kubernetes objects and runs inside the cluster and makes changes to it without really adding any code to Kubernetes itself. So what it'll allow you to do is trigger a node reboot by kubectl. So you as an admin could just annotate a node and then it'll trigger a reboot. And it'll also support managing rolling these reboots across the cluster. So you as an admin can say, I need to reboot every node in the cluster, and you don't need to care about how safe it is to do and which ones you should do. It's going to manage rolling that update across the cluster and making sure only a certain number of pods are down at the same time. So the components of this are going to be an agent which is going to run on all the nodes, and then there's going to be a controller that actually is going to manage how you roll the updates across the cluster. And how they coordinate is going to be through annotations on the node object. So the annotations would just be, you know, reboot now, you need to trigger this immediately, or that it's already in progress, or that this node needs a reboot. So the high-level architecture of how this would be is you have three nodes, and they're each running the agent, and you have your reboot controller running as well. And the states that you're going to be communicating are needs reboot, it's rebooting now, or it's ready. So what we're going to do is, first we'll annotate all the nodes, and we'll say, okay, everyone needs to reboot. As an admin, for whatever reason, I'm just saying every node in the cluster needs to reboot. And we're going to let the controller actually manage this for us so that we don't have to care how many are down. We just say, at some point, we need them all to have rebooted. We've told it that the maximum number of unavailable nodes is one, and so it sees right now there's zero that are down, so it's safe to start the reboot process. So it goes ahead and it reboots that first node, but it's going to stop there because it now has a count of one unavailable node. It's reached our max. We're not going to move on from there. And then that node's going to come back, and then we'll be able to reboot the next. That will come back, and then we'll be able to reboot the last. So pretty straightforward kind of logic, but it's going to manage that rolling across the cluster for us. So the agents itself, how we're actually going to architect this is it's going to be deployed by a daemon set. So this pod's going to end up on all nodes. That's our desired state. It's going to sit there and manage rebooting. And it's got one job, which is essentially watch reboot now annotation. If it sees that annotation show up on its own node, then it knows that it needs to trigger a reboot on the host. And that's about it. The reboot controller, we're going to run as a deployment with a replica of one, and I'll come back to why we do that in a moment. But essentially what it needs to do is it needs to watch all the nodes in the cluster, and it needs to watch for the reboot needed annotation. And so it knows what's the set of nodes that I'm responsible for issuing reboots to. It's going to count the number of unavailable nodes to decide whether it's safe or not to reboot the next node. And while that count is below the maximum that we've set, we'll be able to, we'll just remove the annotation that says a reboot is needed. We'll swap it with the annotation that says reboot now. And then that will trigger the agent that's also watching for that information to just trigger a reboot on the host. The core building blocks of this are going to be kind of three main things. One is just creating a client to interact with the API itself. And then another is using something called an informer that's going to manage our object cache and event handling. And then the last is being able to communicate our desired state. And in this case, we're going to be doing that with annotations on an existing object in Kubernetes, so in this case, nodes. And it's a little bit hard to have some dense code in slides, so there's a full example at kube-controller-demo under my user account on GitHub, so Aaron Levy. And this follows some upstream patterns that are established in building controllers, but there's no singular right way. There's many ways of doing this. You can do this in many different languages. I'm going to go over it using the Go client, but the same pattern, these same ideas are kind of universal. A couple notes about the Go library. So it's under the Kubernetes organization, client Go. One thing to note is that versioning is important with this. You need to make note of that. If you try and run this off of head, it might be a little bit painful. So right now, V2 is what's currently recommended. V3, now this is as of yesterday, because I did this presentation yesterday. But V3, the PR opened yesterday, so that should be landing fairly soon. But everything in this demo assumes V2 functionality. So let's build the reboot agent first. So the first thing that we need to do is we actually need to determine ourself, because if we're the agent, we're operating on a single node, we don't care about anything else that's happening in the cluster. We don't care if other nodes are changing, if they have this annotation, we just care about ourself. And we want to do this because if we have our identity tied to the actual pod, then we're essentially launching pets and not cattle. We want to be able to launch a single daemon set It's going to spread this pod across the entire cluster, and it's going to operate how we want it to. So in this case, the ways that we can determine sulfur are using something called a downward API. And you can see that here under this end section in the pod spec. And what that's saying is that at runtime, I want to populate this environment variable, which is going to be node name, and its value is going to come from a path in the spec, and that's going to be the spec.nodename. So it's just saying that when the kubelet ends up running this pod, at runtime, it's going to populate that information because it will know what node it's actually running on. And this allows us to just write a very general spec, and then that'll just be applied across the cluster, and then we get that information about self. And then we can consume that in our application, either directly using just get it from the environment, or we could actually use that same replacement mechanism in the kubelet runtime as a flag. So when the kubelet runs this, it's actually going to replace that variable with this field path information. And in our case, we'll just use the environment variable. So after we've determined ourself, what we want to do is we want to create a client to speak to the API server. And most of the complexity here is taken care of for us with the client go library. So the important part here I want to go over is actually this middle if block. So there's two sections. The top one is an in-cluster config, and the bottom is a config being loaded from the kubeconfig file. So the in-cluster config means that you're assuming that you're running this inside of a pod, and pods get all of the information they need to securely contact the API server injected into them at runtime. So if you're running as a pod in the cluster, you can just rely on that to give you the location of the API server, how to securely contact it. A service account is inserted into the pod, and so if you need to restrict, you know, the permissions of this controller in some way, then you restrict that service account. So it just makes it really easy. You don't even have to think about it. You just use the in-cluster config. However, during development, that can kind of be a pain because unless you have really nice build tooling, it means you're going to be compiling your binary, putting it into a container, putting that container into a pod spec, and then deploying that pod into your cluster just to test it. So I generally will also allow the option of providing a kubeconfig file because, again, all of these are just clients of the API. So if you have a kubeconfig file that can contact a remote cluster, then while you're developing, you just compile the binary locally, point it at that kubeconfig, and then it can reach out to that cluster while you're testing. It just makes it much easier, so I usually will add that option in. Once you have the config, it's pretty simple. It's just Kubernetes new for config, and that hands you back a client. So given those two things, given we've determined ourselves and we have a client now, it's actually pretty straightforward to use. It's, to getting all the nodes in the, getting a specific node, sorry, in the client is, you know, .core, .nodes, .get, and then we use our node name that we determined through the downward API, and we could print out, for example, how many labels it had. Or we could list all of the nodes in the cluster and then print out how many nodes there are, and then go to sleep and just do this in a loop. So it's a pretty, it takes care of a lot of the library itself takes care of a lot of the complexity for you, and you can start using it pretty easily, quickly. But as I just showed, things like saying client.get, .get, .list over and over again, that can become expensive because you're reaching out to the API. The API is reading from etcd, deserializing that information, doing server-side filtering, reserializing it, sending it to the client, deserializing that information, and then you get to use it. So instead of just calling those multiple times, if you find yourself doing that in code, we actually should end up just using a cache instead. Or instead of trying to constantly poll the API, saying, has anything about nodes changed anywhere in the cluster in the last 10 seconds? Maybe we just want to be notified, hey, this node was added or updated or something like that. And so that just means we need to be actual implementing watching of the API instead. And the client actually does, the client library does this for us. It's an object called an informer. So it handles creating and populating and keeping a cache up to date, as well as firing events. So this is, I'll go into each of these in a little bit more depth, but essentially you're just calling cache.newInformer. And you're going to provide it a listwatch object, which I'll go into in a moment. You're going to tell it what kind of objects you actually care about receiving information about. There's a resync period, and then there are event handler functions that you can pass into this. So what I want to go over first on this is the listwatch object, and the important parts here are the return statements in these two, in the watchfunc and the listfunc. So what it's saying is, this is how you, when you go and you talk to the API server, this is what I want you to do to actually list all objects from the API or watch objects from the API. And in this case, in the case of our reboot agent, like I said, we only care about ourselves. We don't care about updates at all to the rest of the cluster. So we want to restrict this set down. And so that's where we're saying this field selector is just going to be the metadata.name needs to match the node name. And so we're saying the only updates that we care about are ones where it matches our node name. The client is the same, like very similar to how we just saw it being used. We're just saying when you're going to list all objects from the API server, client.core.nodes, and we're going to list them. But our list options are going to say restricted to just this particular field. And same with our watch, we're just going to say when you watch it, restricted to this particular field. So pretty easy to this. These selectors could be label selectors, they could be field selectors. You can restrict down, or you could just say I want to watch everything in the cluster. And then the next big piece are the event handler functions, and you can see the function signatures there, but these fire on add, update, and delete. An example would be maybe we just want to print the node name whenever a node gets added to the cluster for some reason. Receiving the object when that event fires. We know it's going to be a node object, and then we're just printing out the name of it. So you could just add that use that directly as the add function. So the resync period, this is important because this is saying that at this interval, take all the objects that you have in your local cache that the informer is responsible for keeping up to date and refire the update function. Even if there haven't been any changes since the last time it's seen this object, it's going to go through, requeue them all, and then fire that function. And so you, as the person writing this controller, can then use that as a means of resyncing your state. Maybe during the operation of this controller, maybe you've missed messages, maybe operations you were trying to attempt have failed. And rather than just never seeing those again or letting them fall away, you can just assume, all right, well, I'll resync it soon, and it's probably going to be fine. And so I know that during this resync period, I'll requeue all of those objects. I can look at my actual current state, and I can make sure that it moves more towards my desired state, because I know that I'm just going to resync everything in that loop. So given that information, if we were to just call new informer with those things we just talked about, what we would get back is the cache store, and then we would also get the controller object itself. There are some helper objects, so it's stored to node lister, there's also stored to pod lister, et cetera, for most of the API types. And all this does is it takes care of some boilerplate for you. There's like some object conversion stuff that it's pretty easy to do, but may as well not do it if you have these helpers anyway. So generally, when you're getting the cache store back, put it into one of these objects, then you tell the controller to run, and what this means is start populating the local cache, start firing events as things change. And then after that point, the node store that you just created, you can use that much like you would use the client. You could say, well, I want to list everything that's in the cache. I want to get all the objects that I know about, or I want to get a particular object out by me. So let's go over how we would write the actual reboot agent itself. So remember, this is just essentially watch for reboot now annotation, and if we see it, then we just want to reboot the node. So all we actually want to do is we want to watch for updates on the node object. We don't care if a node is being deleted, because if it's being deleted, we don't care about rebooting it. If the node's just being added, we probably don't care about rebooting it right away. So let's just watch when a node object gets updated, something's changed about it. Maybe an annotation got added, then we check if we want to reboot it. So in this case, our update function that we're going to pass into the informer is just going to look, do we have the reboot now annotation? And if we do, remove that annotation, update the object in the API, and then reboot the node. And so our whole program is essentially determine ourselves, get a client, and then we would have a method that takes our clients, our knowledge of self, and this update function, and then creates an informer using that information, and then we just call controller.run. And what it's going to do in the background is it's going to start firing that update event if any nodes get updated with that annotation. So pretty, it makes it really easy. Most of the complexity is actually taken care of with the client code library. And the reboot controller, we're going to do a little bit differently, where this is what's going to be coordinating the reboot across the cluster. So we actually care more about more states here, care about when nodes are added, updated, and removed, because maybe nodes have been added to the cluster and you know, that number, that count of available nodes has changed, or if they're deleted, that count of available nodes has changed. So we're gonna fire the same logic for add, update, and delete. And so for update, normally you're passing the last known old state of the object and the new object itself. In this case, we don't care what the old state of the object was. We're not kind of comparing the transition. We're just caring about the new node itself. So we're just passing that to handler. And the handler function is pretty similar to what we just saw. This one actually cares about reboot needed. So it's looking at the entire state of the cluster, every node, and it's saying, does this have this annotation of reboot needed or not? And so this particular node gets updated, and we're going to check, well, does it have that reboot needed annotation? If it doesn't, then we don't care about anything else about this node, and we can move on. The next thing we would check is, OK, it does have that annotation. It does need to be rebooted. Is it safe for us to do that? And so we would check the number of unavailable nodes and have we hit that max yet. If we have, then it's not safe to reboot it right now. Let's not do anything. And we're just going to assume that in that next resync period, if nothing even happens to this node, we're going to see it again. And so we'll be able to recheck. Maybe our state has changed such that it's safe to actually reboot the node now. And if we get past that, then we know it's safe to reboot another node. And we'll remove the reboot needed annotation. We'll add that reboot now annotation, and then we'll update it in the API. And now by updating it and then adding that annotation, the agent is going to see that change also, and it's going to reboot the node. Just to go over a little bit about how we could use the cache in this state. So the get the number of unavailable nodes, how I was talking about before, where it could get expensive if you're just constantly asking the API, give me all the nodes in the cluster so I can check how many of them are down. In this case, what we could have set ourselves up for is if instead of using the node store, we had the client directly reaching out to the API, it could mean that every time a node object is being updated, we're then going and asking the API, again, give me all the nodes so I can check whether it's safe to reboot this one. So instead of making that expensive call, we already have this cache being populated. Let's just ask the cache directly. And so we can ask, all right, just give me all the nodes that you know about, and I'll iterate through them, and I'll determine, are they rebooting, or are they not ready, and then we can just count it and move on. So a much cheaper operation of just using that cache object that you created as part of the informer, and you know that it's being kept up to date behind. So our update controller that we just went, or our reboot controller, sorry, that we just went over actually has a few bugs that we shouldn't have done, but did for brevity. So one of them is that you shouldn't mutate cache objects. So when I talked about retrieving, a node object out of the store, and then example was changing an annotation and then updating it directly in the API, what could happen here is that if this update call fails, maybe there's a network outage momentarily, you've just invalidated your cache, essentially. You've changed the state of the cache object, and if you operate on it again before it gets updated, you may be making decisions based on bad data. Another risk of doing this is if you have multiple routines that are all using the cache at the same time, which is perfectly valid, you may be invalidating it for something else that's processing based on that cache. So this is pretty easily solved. It's just that you should use a helper api.scheme.copy. So if you need to make changes to an object that you've retrieved from the cache, just make a copy of it first, then make your changes, and then you can safely try and update it in the API, or you know that you're not going to be messing with other routines that might be operating off of that cache. So one of the other things that we need to do is we should wait for the cache to sync. We shouldn't just say controller run and then immediately start processing information. The reason for this is, let's say that we're trying to determine whether it's safe or not to reboot a node. We may not have a full actual state of the cluster yet. The cache may not know about all of the nodes. And so we need to be sure that before we process events, check whether the cache is synced or not, and then we can start processing events because we know, all right, we know about all the nodes. We reasonably should know about all the nodes so far. And we can make decisions about whether it's safe to update them. And again, this is pretty straightforward because the controller itself has a has synced method, but then there's even helpers about waiting for it and stop channels and such. And so the pattern would be create your informer and then wait for it to sync and then start workers that are going to be processing that information. Some other things that I didn't go over that are pretty helpful when writing controllers, leader election, work queues, third-party resources, and shared informers. So I'll go over each of these. Leader election itself, it's not in the client go library yet. there's an open issue about adding it to it. You can vendor it from the Kubernetes repo directly, but you're likely going to end up having to vendor a whole lot of Kubernetes if you do that. So it would be nice, once this makes it into the client Go library, it's pretty helpful. In our case, for the reboot controller, it would enable us to, instead of relying on that replica count equals one, we could safely say that this is going to be, it's safely going to be leader elected, so we can run multiple hot spares of it in the cluster and not just rely on that replica staying as one. Also, a note on this is, if you do want to take a look at this and use it, a good example is either the scheduler or the controller manager. These are both leader-elected components, and one of the first things they do in their code is to leader-elect themselves, so as an example, you can just take a look at those. Another really helpful thing are work queues, and these are not in client v2, but they should be in the next release. These just help because they're, an abstraction and a helper that, you can parallelize workloads. They have a pretty nice work queue type, so there's like rate limiting work queues, and so what this means is maybe you get into a hot loop of failure on a particular object for some reason. It's going to manage backing off on trying to update that object for you, so you can re-add it to the queue and it'll automatically know about backing off. Also, just simply being able to collapse multiple updates into a single work item. Like in our case, for the reboot controller, maybe the node's been updated multiple times and you haven't been able to process it yet. It would collapse all of those updates into one, so you're not kind of doing that as a duplicate process. Another, just pattern-wise, that makes this easy is waiting for the cache to sync before processing events. So your handler functions would actually just be pushing all of your work that you cared about. We would check, does it have an annotation that we care about? Okay, push this onto the work queue. And then our pattern then is, wait for the cache to sync and then start workers whose job is to pull information off of that work queue, and they just wouldn't start until the cache had synced already. Third-party resources. So this is a pretty big topic. And it could easily be an entire presentation. This is pretty heavily used for internally at CoreOS for things like the etcd operator and such. What it allows you to do is dynamically create new API types. So, and then those can be used as a custom data model for your controllers, your operators. And where this can be helpful is that maybe the data structure that you need doesn't map directly into an existing object. So in our case, we're adding annotations to node objects, and it kind of makes sense because we're saying we want to reboot this node so it can be directly to an existing object, but there may be a concept where it doesn't map directly. So for example, the etcd operator, if you wanted to say, I want to cookie cutter stamp out new etcd clusters, there isn't really an existing object that maps that very well, and so instead there's a third-party resource that gets created that then of its type is of etcd cluster, and then you can stamp out new copies of that type, and it has all the information that you would need, like what version of etcd it should be, how many nodes should be in there. So it just makes it really easy for you to have kind of a custom data model, so you don't have to like shim this into existing Kubernetes object types. And then the reboot controller, what we could do with this is maybe we want to extend it and we want to say, well, we're gonna develop reboot groups for it. So we're gonna say, on the master nodes, we're only going to allow one unavailable node at a time, but maybe worker groups based on a label selector are going to allow 10 nodes to be downloaded at a time while we're updating. Just a random example of something we could potentially use third-party resources for. Another one are shared informers. And like we just talked about with those with the informer before, when you create an informer, it's creating an internal representation of a cache of those objects. But you could create multiple informers. But sometimes maybe if we had multiple informers all watching nodes, there may be overlap, and we're now creating multiple caches for node objects, and it can be a little bit inefficient because maybe you can share the same cache for multiple informers. So that's what shared informers are good for. So can lower the memory overhead if you have a bunch of shared data. This is really common in the Kubernetes controller manager because it's like has so many controllers inside of it. They're all operating on the same object types. In practice, I haven't really used it because whenever I've been writing controllers, it's often like single use. So in this example of a reboot controller, it cares about, the controller itself cares about all nodes, and the agent cares about one node. And so there isn't a whole lot of use there for using a shared informer, but it's good to note that it exists because in certain use cases it can't help. The behavior is slightly different, and it's just important to know, if you are going to use them, to be aware of that changed behavior. So some helpful resources if you are going to write some controllers. There are, under the community repository, contributors, devel, controllers.md. This is a really good document that goes over a lot of the same stuff that I talked about of, what to do, what not to do, the helpers that exist, just some good design principles. But also below, in the design proposals itself, there are design principles about control logic in Kubernetes and certain patterns that you should follow. And that's internal to Kubernetes, but you could use this as well in your own development. In the Kubernetes code base, package controller is the home of most controllers in Kubernetes. So typical things like the services and nodes and pods and daemon sets, all of those are in there, and it's a good place to just go look, well, how are they doing things internally in the upstream project, and maybe I can use some of those patterns myself. The client Go repository has an examples directory. This has some examples of how to interact with like third-party resources, and as well as like creating clients and such. This demo, I wouldn't say use it, but it's a good reference implementation of what we just talked about, but a full working demo. And then also I wanted to point to another project that didn't use client Go, but is kind of following these same patterns. And this was written in Python, so the memcached under kdst on GitHub is another project. So I have. Thank you guys. Is there any questions?
So, when would you suggest using annotation versus third-party resources?
Sorry, say again.
So when would you use annotations versus third-party resources? When the object is not complicated enough, so you don't really need third parties?
Right. I mean, just for the less complexity standpoint, I would lean towards annotations when you can, but it matters more that you're annotating an existing Kubernetes object, so it might feel really, like, unless you're just using it as an arbitrary place to store information, like you're gonna annotate, a pod that never gets used or something like that. It feels kind of weird, but you're just using it as a place to dump data. I feel like in that case, it might make more sense to think about maybe a third-party resource would be a better option for this. Like I said, in the reboot controller, it's like we're operating on nodes. That's what we care about. And so it maps very directly to, I want to extend the node object to have the idea about reboot state. And so sometimes things just map very directly to an existing object because that's what you're operating on. Sometimes they don't. The other thing about third-party resources is you create an API type, and then you can stamp out copies of that. And so you're actually creating multiple resources of it. And sometimes that's better than, if you could dump, I guess, information into a single object in an annotation, but let's say that you needed multiple representations of it, it might not make sense anymore, and it might feel like really kludgy what you end up having to do. Yeah?
What happens when the reboot controller reboots itself?
Like the same node?
Yeah,
I mean, it should just come back because it's already been scheduled, but you could protect against that in the logic itself. So maybe you could say, be aware of self and make sure the node that I'm scheduled on, I shouldn't, don't reboot me. But because the state isn't in the controller, the state is in the objects of the node objects themselves, it's just going to go down and then come right back up. And it's the same thing as if it missed messages. It's going to resync all of its state. It's going to walk all of the nodes and say, well, I only got 5 out of the 10 nodes rebooted because 5 of them still have reboot needed, and then I'm just going to continue operation again. So that's actually like a good pattern is that, if you contain all of it, if your state is actually in the controller itself and you put it in a state where if it goes down, that you come back up in a bad state where you can't recover from, like relook at like how that's built, and there's probably a pattern there where you can keep it separate, it can come back, and it can just resolve it again. Because network outages, nodes going down, itself dying, these are things that should just be normal operation. And kind of the reason for this pattern of, always check the current state and just constantly be driving towards that desired state.
The controller runs in the pod. Do you make sure that the pod can access the API, the Kubernetes API? Do you need to give some privilege to the pod or not?
So that's managed by, so if we go back.
Can you repeat the question?
Oh yeah, so the question was, does the pod need to be given information to be able to contact the API? Let me go back to the slide. So that's where this in-cluster config comes from. And so every pod that gets launched into the cluster automatically gets a service account injected into it. And so if you don't define anything, if you say nothing, then it gets a default for that namespace service account. And if you don't restrict that at all, it can do anything pretty much in the cluster. So given that service account that gets injected, that's how it can contact the API server. And the service account is a couple of things. Part of it is that in the pod, a environment variable will be injected that says this is the addressability of the API server. And then the other part is that it will inject a the certificate authority for the API server's certificate, and then it'll also inject a token that has been generated that it can use for opt-in. And then using that information, the in-cluster config, it already knows where to look on the file system and what environment variables to consume. And then it can create the config that says, okay, this is the token, this is the address, and this is the certificate to trust when I make requests to the API server. So it's kind of taking care for you. You could, if you really wanted to, provide other methods of contacting the API server. It just means that you have to build them into the pod itself. Like you could put it in the file system. It could be a secret that gets mounted in. But generally, it's just so flexible to be able to just say, I'm going to launch this pod, and I know that the service account is going to be injected into it. Just use it. And then the service account itself, you can specify which service account you want that pod to get in the pod spec. So inside of the daemon set, you could actually say, this is the service account I want this to use. And then maybe you want to restrict down the scope of what that controller can actually do. And so you just create that service account that says, you're going to be scoped to only allow these few things. And then the pod gets, whenever it gets scheduled, wherever it is, it gets that service account, and then it contacts the API and it only has the permissions you want. So I would lean towards that versus trying to put in your own information into the pod itself. Any other questions? Well, thank you so much.